nonprofit association, also a partner with San Diego Social Venture Partners. When we started thinking about this conference, we thought, we're in the communication business. We're in the messaging business. And whether you're a big company, small company, service provider, freelancer, nonprofit organization, development director, communications director, we all use the same medium. And we can all be more effective. So that's what we're here. Think of this as 24-hour fitness. And the more you make notes, and the more we participate and things like that, and ask questions, okay, we're going to leave here and have all kinds of fun and have some great information as you leave. That's part of our goal. And I'd like to welcome a couple of people that have made this whole thing possible. And that is our overall corporate sponsor for the San Diego Nonprofit Association. That's Eric Siebold. Eric is here. And Eric, would you like to say a couple words? Hello. Be sure to stop by. And Eric is with TriNet. So remember, net, bottom line, net. Gross income, net return, and three triple bottom line reporting, things like that. The mega trend of outcomes and outputs and ROI, things like that. You want to say you're good?
That's fine.
Be sure to stop by. He's got lots of goodies and information to help you with your HR, financial. So again, he's the money guy. Save you time, save you money. Very important. And our education guru, I'd like to introduce you to Shannon McDonald, who is the marketing manager for UCSD Extension, and she's providing this information in this room and stuff like that. And I had the great pleasure working with Shannon many years ago, and she is a definite guru of communication.
Hi, everybody. Thanks, Parker, for that introduction. How many of you have been to UCSD Extension's facility before? Great. How many of you have taken a course at Extension before? Not enough hands are raised. Okay, I'm going to solve that problem for you today. You're going to come visit me back here. You're going to find a course that you like, and you're going to join us at some point. We have a variety of courses here at Extension. We have 14 different areas of study. We have 4,500 courses you can choose from, and whether you're looking for a guitar class or a data analysis class, we've got it, and everything in between. So please come visit me today. We're in the back here. We have online and face-to-face courses for everybody's needs. We even have programs for your kids and programs for those who are retiring. So anywhere on your continuing education spectrum, we've got it for you. So if you have any questions, please come see me. Thank you so much for being here today. We really appreciate it, and have a wonderful time this morning.
Thank you, Shannon. And back to providing resources and information. A couple people, in fact, we're going to allow time for you to network, and in between each presentation, which will be 15 minutes, we'll try and raise the flag and interrupt everybody if that's possible, and stop the questions. But I know there's a lot of energy, and I've had the great pleasure of listening to and watching Kevin before, and he's just a wealth of information. You have the bios on the invitation and information, so I'm not going to go through and read those to you, because you're here to listen to these guys. But just one quick introduction, a couple of people. One is David Palmer. David is in the back. He's the president of the American Marketing Association. He'll be introducing our speaker at 11 o'clock, and he scared the heck out of me when he said, "Well, Parker, this is the first annual Foresight. We're going to do this again? Yes! If you'll give us some feedback, and maybe..." But the idea is, since we're all in the communication business, why don't we tap on the shoulder of the four best, largest communication associations, professional associations. Let's give them an opportunity to share their knowledge, provide a stage for them, and thanks to UCSD, they have done that. Also, Larry Kesslin, you here. Larry. Larry is in the process of starting, you're going to love this, Purpose San Diego. Not quite sure where this is going, but every month there's a get-together. And right now we're at the Corporate Alliance. It will probably morph into a facility and venue at UCSD. But grab Larry's business card if you're interested in Purpose San Diego. It's companies, it's nonprofits, it's social sector leaders getting together once a month and more. So there's an afterlife to these types of things that we're doing. Okay, with that, and pretty much on time, I'd like to introduce Kevin Popovic, Supreme Guru of information and knowledge.
That works.
And
that works.
Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thanks for having me, Jimmy. I can develop a communications plan, just kind of turn one of these damn things on. I'll go enhance that. Motion video, how's everybody doing today?
Good.
So I'll tell you, I'm going to start without this, and then if you can't hear me, my wife will be surprised, and I will not feel the problem. So my name is Kevin Popovic, and I'm here to tell you about how to get market ready or to know how your business is, if your business is ready to compete. How many people believe their business is ready to compete in their marketplace? Raise your hand. How many people don't know? How many people are afraid of knowing? Right, very much the same thing. So what I really want you to think about as we're looking about this, I want you to think about that one, right? How to know your business is really, really ready to compete, right? A lot of us are, most of us are in the communications business in one way or another, right? Marketing, advertising, branding, designers, internet, PR, et cetera, et cetera. So the so we know the things that we're supposed to do, right? We've been in this business a long time. I've been in this business a long time, right? I've had Ideahaus, which is a creative communications agency, since 1990. Yes, I started as a sixth grade project in grade school. And I'm very proud of the different things that we've done. And since we've started in 1990, we've been creative communications. I had a guy say, so you're an ad agency. Well, yeah, well, we do advertising, but we do all forms of communication. They're like, oh, so you're like a marketing shop. I'm like, well, we do marketing, but we do a lot of different things. And he goes, oh, so you're a design shop? I'm like, thinking about this, how am I going to explain to this guy? I said, it's a little more like I'm Bruce Lee, and I learned all these different forms, and I can kick your ass with whatever I got laying on. Right? So from the professional experience, I'll move over to academic experience. My background is communications and psychology. My master's is in multimedia technology. My doctoral studies were in instructional technologies. So all in all, I know a lot of stuff. I've written a couple books. 20 years communications gets 20 of my colleagues to answer the same 20 questions. And I look at the group learning from that. Satellite marketing created a process for social media because I think we needed a process. And I looked at a model and how would things work. And I feel like it figured out rubrics, because how could I score a social network? And I figured out all the different little steps in between how we get from a communications vehicle to the prospect and what can go along the way. I wrote a book, an e-book, View from the Top, The Evolution of the Marketing and Customer Journey. Obviously I've got a lot of free time. Right? But I give you this to understand the context of what I'm going to share with you today. Right? So I know some things. That's my wife says, honey, you're so smart. I'm like, I know some stuff. Right? So I want to talk about the stuff that we all know about. Right? We all know about branding. Who knows about branding? Right. So many of us know about branding. For those of you who don't know about branding, and we could go on and split hairs about definitions, but it's really about developing that presence. Right, it's the name, it's the logo, it's what becomes recalled when they think of your company, your organization, right? And there's some different parts of branding, right? Many of you have probably worked on branding for your organization. So my premise today is, if we know so much, why is there so much bad work out in the business place, right? If we know so much, and we know all the right people in our networks, why is there so much bad branding, right? And when I talk about bad branding, right, I'm not just like, ooh, I like it, ooh, I don't like it. I'm like, no, man, that thing's about 76. What's a 76? Follow along and I'll tell you what a 76 is, right? So when we look at branding, a lot of times we'll look at the logo, tagline, art element, things along this line, right? So this is one that I just randomly found that I thought served as a good example. Right, and then you'll get some people who says, well, I like this, they've got a nice brand, right? I like their brand. Well, let's talk about what do you like about it, right? Because when I start looking at this thing, right, I start looking at it as different components. As a creative director, I break it down, right? There's the name that the client gave me, unless we were part of the ideation on the name. There's the tagline, there's the type that you use, there's the art element, there's the overall structure and the impact that it makes when it all comes together. Right, so in my free time, I broke down every type of communication that you can have and a way to score it. Right? So this is how we start looking at branding. And if we start looking at branding like this, then it becomes less qualitative, I like it or don't like it, and much more quantitative. It has a score, right? And then if you share a set of target scores or benchmarks with that, now you can objectively say, our branding is good, our branding is bad. Our branding really needs some work off the data points. Make sense? Right, so this is how I think when we look to how are we going to get the ROI out of communications, this is the approach that I think we have to take. Because everybody's already looking at we spent this much money, right? They use the word spend, it's not invest. And then there's some magical formula that depending on who you are that you concoct. Like if it's your project, like everything goes into like making the number get bigger. Right? And if you're in another department, you're taking pot shots like, well, I don't know why we're putting that one in there. And you're trying to make the number go lower, because that's what people do. Right? So the perspective on the ROI is very subjective. But that's post-implementation. What about ahead of time? What about before they put all that money into media and events and everything else? What if you can know, give or take a couple percentage points, if you were really ready to compete? Would that be helpful? Raise your hand if you agree. No, I thought the same thing. Right? So, we can look at all the channels of communication in a similar fashion. So I put together some examples of how we look at different pieces in each of the 10 channels of communication. Because like the smartass who wanted to say, oh, you're a jack of all trades, master of none. No, I look at, I've always looked at communications as this very big umbrella, right? And it was predicated on the thought that when I was a young agency trying to figure out how I'm going to get people to give me money, right? And I heard this AOR thing, you know, AOR, agency of record, right? Ooh, what's that about? Ooh, they give you a check every month. Really? Tell me more of this. How am I going to get them to do this stuff? So I couldn't understand if a business said, I'm going to take care of your communications, we're your agency, how you didn't take care of everything that you really needed to take care of. You know? So in marketing, right, my dad's a professor of marketing, and so I grew up with an awful lot of marketing stories. Right? And being in a creative agency, I've seen a lot of different types of work. Right? So when we take a look at different marketing pieces, right, like a sample brochure, a simple little brochure that many of us have done over time, what are the pieces in it? Because a lot of times we just look at it, I like it, I don't like it. Or if you're a copywriter, you're like, the headlines are horrible. Like, you know, who wrote this stuff? If you're a designer, like, I could have done a better job. Yeah, we all could have. And we all know what makes a good brochure, right? Who's pretty confident that if somebody quizzed you, that you would be able to come up with most of the answers of what makes a great brochure? Raise your hand, please. A little lower than I thought. Right. So, for those of us who do know, why have you worked on brochures that haven't been very good? Right. You know that the headline's bad, but the headline still makes it into production anyway. You know that they've used some pictures that aren't the best pictures. You know all these things, but nonetheless, as we look in the marketplace, we see all this horrible marketing collateral. Right. So there's a lot of reasons why it makes it to it, but what if we could look at it in a different way and start looking at the elements, design, images, impact, copy, subheads, headline. This is all stuff that every brochure has, right? So if you had a process to say, okay, listen, once something comes in, we'll evaluate it through some rubric, just like we do at school, just like you did when you were in school, then we could get a more of an objective evaluation of, are we ready to go move forward with this as a tool in our toolbox? Okay. So these are some of the different ways that we look at brochures, right? And then we take a look at advertising, right? How many times have you seen a spot on television and you're like, who wrote this stuff? Right? I yell at the TV all the time. I'm like, seriously? You gave that map? But you could have given that to us. So advertising has gotten very complex, right? It used to be easy, TV, radio, outdoor, and print. Right? Who remembers back in the day where you just had to worry about like ABC, CBS, and NBC? I know, right? And they just had the Love Boat reunion. I was thinking, man, remember where you could get a million people on a Thursday night. So there's a lot of things that have changed in advertising, and there's a lot of things that have stayed the same. right? One of the things that have stayed the same, some of those base components in an app, right? So I pulled this app from Jaguar, right? And all this stuff is really kind of randomly pulled. You take a look at what any basic print ad is going to have. Got a headline, got some copy, there's call to action, there's visuals, there's design, there's branding, and has an overall impact, right? As opposed to, I like the ad, I don't like the ad, I wish I had a car, I wish I didn't have a car. What really goes into these ads? It's repetitive. It's the same type of thing over and over. So if there is this commonality in structure, can't we just say, hey, when we evaluate things, we'll just keep the same, we'll just look for the same things, and we'll put a score, and then we'll have the quantitative to complement the qualitative, plus all the political crap that comes with getting an ad approved anyway, right? You know, the art director has a great idea. And let me just go off on just a mild tangent, because I don't want to discount the reality of the business that most of us work in, right? You get a great idea. Now, it depends whose great idea is it. Client's great idea, right? Creative director's idea, junior art director's idea. Very different weighting on the ideas. Which ones make it to the meeting? Who's presenting it, right? You know, how often is the creative director horribly underpresenting the junior art director's idea? So all that crap happens, right? And then you make it to the client meeting. Right, which client? The good client or the bad client, right? What kind of day are they having? What kind of budget? Who has to get sign off along the way? There's this horrible formula that actually is a real thing to think about, than how these things even get this far. That being said, we can't control all of that stuff, and as part of the evaluation process, we can start remembering what we've learned from all these different channels of communication and apply it to each channel of communication. And that's what we're trying to do with this. Now, design. Design is great. Design is probably one of the more loose communications channels that we have, right? Because you start talking about what is design, right? And I don't want to get off into that. I'll save that for the AIGA meeting. But when we look at design components, right, the things that we look at, again, similar to others, right? This was an annual report that I found. I hope nobody worked on this, because this is my lowest scoring piece, I think. So you take a look at things, for instance, like the title. Now, I don't want to discount context as well. So the 2016 ASCD annual report showcases the association's accomplishments, successes, and key efforts during the 2016 fiscal year. This year's report illustrates ASCD's new mission model, which defines and guides our work and puts the whole child at the forefront of everything we do. Now, with that in mind, right, I started looking at this thing like, really? This made it? Right, so the title, Celebrating Learning. That thing is going back. You get a 3, right? 3's bad. Red, bad. Right, green, good. Orange, you better look at it again. Right, very basics, again, what we need. But are you telling me that this is the annual report, and that's what they're trying to accomplish? This headline's horrible, right? Same thing, stories of teaching and learning. Right, this is like one of those bad, what's the magazines, the highlights magazines, your dentist when we were kids. Right? See, this is your annual report, and you have accomplishments, successes, right? I'm looking at the branding. If I hid this, you would have no idea who it was, right? Same thing, I'm looking at the images. That's like, okay, well, we have these bad stock images that somebody gave us for free. Why don't we just reuse those, right? Copy, was it's just a quote. There's no setup. Design, it's not a bad design, right? But there's just nothing good in it. It's colorful. It's nice use of color blends. But overall, it's not a good piece, right? I scored this in 4.5, right? I mean, you should be in like a 7, 8, an annual report, right? And this is where it's just kind of like gut feels that this is an annual report, and you're on a 0 to 10 score, and this is your project. Where do you want it to come in? What number? 10, right? Yeah, this is your project. Right, even with giving some concessions to the client wants this and there's something like this and blah blah blah, they really like pink, yeah, I want pink and whatever. You gotta get it north of an 8. Right? But nonetheless, people make decisions, they approve work like this, and it goes out. Right? And you wonder why you're not getting your ROI. Because you're not stepping up to the best practices that we know damn well we should have in a piece. So this this little rant goes on down now. Personal responsibility, doing your part, right? And I know this changes over time. Remember when you first got into business? I'm going to change the world. Wait till they see what I can do. And every fight's the right fight to get into, right? And then, you know, you get your hand slapped a little bit, and, you know, and then you're like, well, I might pick my fights a little better, right? You know? And then, you know, you're like 10 years out from retirement, like, I don't care what the hell I do.
Right? I celebrate learning.
Right? So, so I understand there are these other influences in our work and what makes it to the light of day. But while you still got skin in the game, while you're still trying to make a difference, what if you looked at things a little differently? Take a look at the internet. Now, internet was, it still remains, like, the jackpot of all communications, right? Remember when they said, oh, you build a web, the internet, you get a website, everybody will come and buy stuff from you. Bullshit, man. Everybody just made more websites. And then you couldn't find anything. And then you're like, oh, wow, a search engine. And then they'll find you. Yeah, you know, who's putting money into SEO? Right, how's that heroin addiction treat you? You're like, oh, yeah, it feels good. First page, yeah. Gotta stay on first page. So, you know, and then you have to keep putting money on it. So they made all these promises, right? So, yeah, you'll hit those lotto stories of like, oh, somebody got a million. Yeah, that's great. It's like somebody won the lotto in Chula last night. I think somebody won $1 million last night. It wasn't you. It wasn't you, and you didn't win it either. Most of us didn't win $1 million. So when we look at things on the internet, again, how can we make sure we get at least a little closer to our $1 million? So again, we know basic branding thing. Hey, this thing is for a business. Do you know what business is for? Yes, the logo's on it. Is it dominant? No, but you know, they didn't do a bad job on it, right? It wasn't a great logo to begin with, a little thing, but they had it placed well. You take a look at the headline, right? How many golfers in here? Right, if you saw Play More Golf, would you read more? I figured you would, that's why I gave it a 7. I don't think I played like mini golf, anybody goes to Pelly's? I got a strong short game. Copy was 5, there really wasn't much to it. It promotes some features, a call to action, go in the beta. Sure, man, it's very clear it does what it does. But the images were poor, and the product placement, they got to do product placement, but let me read you now the context around this. Club Debit is an app that's been designed especially for golfers, from scheduling tee times and staying updated on country club news to learning the details of more than 18,000 courses around the country. Club Debit is the perfect solution for any avid golfer who is looking to stay organized. Right, with that they're shooting for, I'm like, meh, right, 6.4, right, could have done better, right, where's the pictures of the golf courses? How about like a bunch of little things with like golf course,
you're okay.
Pictures of golfers, I don't know, man, like, bag of golfs, there's a lot of different things you can do. So that's why I say there's one thing to look at it from a visual standpoint and a takeaway, but understanding in your context helps as we're trying to really evaluate, is this ready to go forward in the market? Any questions about how we're approaching this so far? Yes?
I just have a question. So when you take each of these, it is still based on your knowledge and your expertise what you rate features as?
Well, it's based on me and some guys I hang out with who have spent much too much time in academia, 20 years plus in business, and they teach today. So this is guys like, you know, when we go out for beers, like, see that app? Yes. Right, you know, and they start going, why? Well, you know, according to so and so, and this, you know, this model, blah 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 blah. So it's a business and academia mix.
And it takes so it's just and breaking it down so it's more so your client can take it in a little bit better.
Well, they don't like to take it. Yeah, nobody wants to say. So nobody, you know, and that's what I think we get a lot of hesitation with. Nobody wants to know how they did, right? So I liken this to like your senior project, right? So I teach at State, right? And we get projects turned in, and then I've got 50 students in my class, and I'm just taking the red line to the paper, right? Or electronically, we're using Turnitin. Anybody familiar with Turnitin on Blackboard? Right? So the concept's the same way. You upload a piece, there's a rubric next to it, and you start scaling it.
right? There's different statements that says the headline does this, the subhead does this, the subhead doesn't do this, and then there becomes points with it, right? So it's based on a same type of grading approach to it, but with the rubrics, we just get some content because it's different, right? Like if you took creativity and innovation with me, it's different if you took it to Bernie Schroeder, right? Or any two professors are going to just score something just a little off. So that was one of the reasons that we did the rubrics, because I was scoring some things, and then you get, you know, one of my buddies who's like uber branding lord, right? So he's like super hard on the branding. You start to get a little bit off on things. So that's how we're trying to bring more continuity to it.
So for each of those items that, like, say, copy, do you have a rubric for what is a 5, what is a 7, what is a 2? Oh,
yeah.
So it breaks it down.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's a lot of work on it, and they're going through evolutions. But this has seemed like it was the much more accurate way. Because I've been in client meetings where there's just stuff that I wanted to get to market, and I'm like, oh, I know how to do this. I'm going to go see this guy ahead of time, tell him this, right? I'm gonna do this. So we can make stuff go. But that isn't the right way to do it, right? That was younger me, who I had an ego. Not that I don't have a little bit of ego still. But this is one way that I just felt that it was much more, let's call it professional, accurate. Because at the end of the day, we're all trying to move a needle, right? Needle just doesn't move itself, right? You have a plan, and you build tools that the plan needed, and then you implemented the plan, right? And then you babysat that thing, and if something went south, you jumped on it, right? And that's what many of us get paid to do, right? Come up with a plan, make me the stuff, run it, and tell me how awesome it was so I hire you again, right? So that was really a lot of the motivation behind trying to address something like this. Any other questions about this approach to evaluation? How many people in general like being evaluated? Yeah, right? Yeah. I know, most know, right? That's very, it reinforces the lack of people who went through the self-assessment before they came today. Although some of the people that did, I thank you, because I use your scores as an example at the end here. Right? Let's talk about social media. Who's a big fan of social media? Who hates social media? Who still doesn't get why the hell we spend so much time with? Yeah, me either, right? Although I wrote a book on the damn thing just because I told somebody I would once. So social media, that's people using content and technology to communicate with other people in a social network, right, as I define it. Because I think some people want to make social media a lot more complicated than it is. And it really isn't, right? It's got more moving parts, but most things digital these days do. When we look at social media, we can look at different types of promotions. Now, this is one I found for Tide. I thought it was interesting. And I use those words because I saw some of the reports on this afterwards. And you go to Tide's website, and it was awesome. And you go to all the consumer sites, and it was a flop. Right? So I don't know the data points on it, but when we start evaluating a promotional page like this, what we see is the branding, right? It is very well branded. You know this is a Tide bit, right? It's got product placement, great product placement in it. Solid design. The copy's a little underwhelming. I think they could have done some more with that. Sharing functionality. It's got a call to action in it. You know, overall, it's a 7.3, right? But these are the types of different vehicles. This is all it really is a different container. It still has the same stuff in the container. Right? We know when we hear a great headline and a lousy headline. Right? We know a solid call to action when a call to action is barely a call to action. You don't know if you're supposed to click on this thing. Is this what I do? I click? Right? So again, we bring what we know already as best practices into any environment, even though it's new technology, a new channel of communications like social media is, and if we do some basic evaluation, right, we know, is it good, is it bad? Is it ready to move forward into the marketplace and put dollars on it, right? And I think this kind of approach is helpful at the individual level before, you know, like when you're doing your own work, right? It's hard to say, you know, you're doing your own work, you apparently made decisions because you think these were the right decisions to make. I put this headline in, I use this image, I composite it here, and this is what I think we're gonna do, right? Now, are you gonna be able to objectively say, I did a good job, I did a bad job? I'm asking, who's going to be able to objectively say they did good or bad on their own work? Yeah? You feel pretty comfortable about that? Okay. How many people don't think they have the ability to be objective on their own work? I agree with you. I don't think that you either did too, right? So my job is to tell you, like, what work is good and what work is bad. As I tell my clients, I'll tell you which one of your kids is ugly. That's my job to do, man. Like, the middle one. She's the ugly one, right? Now let's get past this, right? That's a lot of time what my job is, right? My wife tells me, she goes, all you do is, like, point out stuff that's wrong. I said, well, you know, I can just tell you what's right. You know, you still going to pay me for what's right? Oh, you did a great job. Give me all that money. No, you want to know what's wrong. Yes?
Just a question. Could you break down the impact? How do you judge the impact?
Yeah, we took a look at the, like, the total piece. Impact is, like, if I just look at it.
I'm a fundraiser, not a marketer. So
impact will mean a little different things to us.
Yeah.
So impact score is just that as a whole. When I see this thing, the first impression that it makes, I take it all in, we give it a score. Mm-hmm. Any other questions about this process? Yes?
Where would we find the definition of that?
Where would you find our reverse? Mm-hmm. Inside my competitively priced program. Yes?
Do you weight everything differently?
We do weight some things differently. Like at the beginning of our process, much like you would evaluate the work based on, for instance, the type of business. Like, so B2C has the highest demand on it because consumers are just cutthroat, right? So B2B is a little less. Nonprofits, we scored a little lower on that, right? So it's we're more critical of the B2C than we are the nonprofit stuff.
I meant the relative weight between the different metrics.
Oh, but the different types?
In calculating the overall.
Yeah, we do, because there's some things like, I'll give you for instance. So impact is weighted more heavily than something a little lesser, like maybe a subhead. Maybe just kind of two different things. Headline is weighted more than a subhead. The product image is weighted probably almost equally as where the branding is. So there are some things that, yes, that it's more important than others, and we reward that score accordingly. Any other questions so far?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
How do you incorporate conversion with your weight or your scoring process? You know, conversion being more quantitative.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes the ugly black and white converts more than the ones with a bunch of colors. So how do you balance that to get a score that's effective at the end?
So we've had clients that have submitted a campaign. They'll say, here's all the ads in the campaign. You know, you'll have full page, half page, black and white color ads. And then sometimes, for instance, that they'll kind of cheat out on it. You know, they'll just drop the color out of Photoshop. The image kind of goes flat, or they'll shoot a black and white and it pops a little more. So we do take into consideration the individual ads. Again, in context, too, you know, because the black and white ads tend to run in lower-end publications, right? You may get something like a Penny Saver or something, as opposed to half-page in, like, San Diego Magazine. So the media that it runs into will also impact it. Because we have to do it in context, right? Hey, I got this thing, right? But tell me how you're using the thing, right? And then who are you trying to get to pay attention to the thing? So we're looking at demographics, you know, age, gender, geographic location, income. We're looking at what the sales have been over the last 2 years, projected out, what your cost per transaction is. So we can really take it in constants. You're trying to sell something to who at what the price point, and how many of these are you trying to sell? Right, onesies, twosies is one thing. I got to move a million of these things. That ad is not going to move a million of these things. And that's what we score that way as well. Other questions? Let the games continue. Multimedia. Right? Now, multimedia can mean a lot of things. In this instance, we use an example of an explainer video. Anybody not know what an explainer video is? Okay, so thank you for your honesty. The explainer video are those little 30, 60, 90 second videos when you show up on somewhere where you don't know where you're at, and a little video comes on and explains where you're at or what the product is or what's going on here.
You mean it online?
Online.
Okay.
Yeah, more often online. Sometimes you'll see them at kiosk. Sometimes they'll be within an app, but just some little video. So they're very kind of hot and trendy. But we take a look at the total piece. So instead of it being a static print ad, we have to take a look at the entire piece. And some of the things that we take a look at, of course, is design, process. How well does it explain the process? The call to action, for in this instance, this last frame was a call to action. After all this other magical crap that they did ahead of time, and all this nice little stuff, yeah, non-like black type, but that's you like run out of money with your fiber guy right about here. So these are the types of things that we have to do over time. You look at what the message is, what the voiceover is, because the words that's on the script is one thing. The delivery by the person reading it is quite another thing, right? And then you look at the whole motion and fluidity. So multimedia does have some unique properties to it, but again, nothing that we haven't seen in a TV commercial, right? Or we haven't seen in something else, right? So you can look at this, for instance, like on Flash, well, I wouldn't say Flash, but like HTML5, things where you can go on and interact. Like Mini used to have a great little car builder. Anybody ever remember the Mini site where you could go build a Mini? Yeah, I went on like one year, like I got a $19,000 Mini up to like 39.6, right? And this like little go-kart, yeah, $40,000 go-kart, yeah. But you could go on and have this positive experience on this multimedia piece. It was much more than just pick out all the crap that you want in your overpriced toy. There was little bits of information, and they had little sound effects, and it was a really interesting user experience, and it had a good user interface. Right? Those are the types of things that we're starting to see in multimedia. Right? Remember, multimedia, right? Many types of media put together in some things. So it's not just video. It can be a lot of different things. Now, public relations. How many people are in the PR biz here? All right. Always hiding out in the back. We got some people front row here. All right. So I did see a number of applications for the self-assessment in PR. I'm very interested in what you see in some events, right? So this is one of the ways that we're looking at events. Now, this was for a product release of Zenbo, your own personal robot, which, who doesn't like robots? Anybody a big fan of robots? I want a personal robot, right? I think you could be fun. But this one, I look at like product placement. -9. The guy did a great demo. You have to watch kind of the whole event and the release to get all this stuff. Presenter did a great job. He had an 8. Audience, they had a great audience assembled for it. We had an 8. It was very well branded. It was very well positioned. They got a lot of engagement. Right? These are the types of things when we start looking at the different components in public relations. You can look at a press release. You can look at a media event. You have a product rollout, right? There's a lot of different tools that we use in PR that if we bring the same thinking to it, we can come up with some sort of quantitative evaluation that says, you know, are we ready to move forward? And then again, how did we do? Now, events. I used to be in the events business back in the day, and I have been to quite a lot of events. How many people have been to a Salesforce event? Right? So, back me up on the scoring on this one. So, branding, Salesforce always does a great job, right? You see that damn logo everywhere. Happy cloud, lots of colors, they blow a lot of money on that stuff. Right? Invites are usually pretty nice, they do good messaging, they put together a decent program, not a great program, a decent program. They always have a nice venue. They get a lot of people in the audience. It's a decent experience, it's a decent engagement. But is it the best conference you've ever gone to? Never. Has anybody ever been to the sales conference event and think it's the best event that they've ever gone to? No, me either. Right? And that's when we start looking at this. I'm wondering why. You're thinking like Jesus money. You're like, Jesus, how do you have so much money? And they have these big events, man, and they get thousands of people. But none of them are awesome. Why not? Don't know. I'm not on their team, but it's really more of a rhetorical question. Why not? You have this much money. You have this powerful of a brand. You have this many zealots running around saying, "Oh my God, I'm with Salesforce." Hashtag Salesforce. Right? But they're just not over the top. I don't know. You know, maybe they should try scoring this a little better before they put all that money into it, right? But there's these different impacts. If they, you know, they couldn't do better on the branding. I mean, those damn things are like, they're so well branded. And I think that they have a lot of great assets and attributes to their brand. You know, invites are good. They're always cute. They spend a ton of money on the invites. And I'm just not sure how to make the changes. I just know that they're coming up. And before I would sign off on putting this much money in another Salesforce event, I think I would try to figure this out. Yes?
I think of the cloud conference up in San Francisco. I think sometimes they're so busy branding themselves that they don't focus back on just simple solutions for customers.
Yeah. Well, you know, they run, like, you know, they have keynotes, they run multi-track, they run, like, every variation of it.
But it's overwhelming, and it doesn't allow people to really focus on what they need versus they're in a rah-rah Salesforce.
Yeah, you know, when it's like, it's like the Salesforce groupies, I'm here, I got all this swag, I saw all these people, I want all these things, then you go home, and what do you change? Probably not too much. Right? You already bought into Salesforce for a ton of money.
And everything costs more.
Yeah.
So
this is the thing that I think has been the start of great conversations. You have everything you can want in a client, so why aren't they killing it? And, like, and what does kill it mean for an event for Salesforce? You know, and then what can we learn from somebody who makes these mistakes continually so that we don't make them when we finally get our clients to invest in doing some similar events? But at least by breaking it down here, you start looking at the different aspects and the different pieces of an event, just like we do in the other channels, right? What are the pieces? How are each of the pieces doing? Cumulatively, how are they coming together? And then what can we do to improve the efficacy of the channel that we're working on? Let's talk about sales. Anybody directly responsible for sales? All right. So how many times have you seen, like, something like this come out? Like, oh, we got a new brochure for the sales guys. Guys, here's the new product shots. Here you go. Throw away the old stuff. Use all this stuff. Right? I got to say that I have been guilty of manufacturing stuff that looks similar to this in the past because I didn't tell my client who was paying me a godly amount of money that he was wrong. Right? We see things like this, right? So from a production standpoint, it's a nice piece. You know, they put a couple dollars into this thing, it comes together, sure, right? Headlines are horrible, product shots, right? The products are all listed, presentation of the products, poor, right? Messaging, fine. Copy, they did a decent job, but it was a bunch of Me Too crap that, like, any other, like, you know, industrial B2B business is gonna put, right? I could have swapped the product out, changed the logo, and it probably would have fit any other manufacturer. And this is a lot of that Me Too crap that too often salespeople get handed from marketing and says, okay, here's your stuff, good luck, right? And this stuff doesn't work. So we're sending salespeople out with stuff that they are ill-prepared to compete with in the marketplace, right? We already know sales is a tough job. And sales tools help the salesperson kill the prey, drag it back, and everybody feeds. So it is our collective best interest to help sales prepare for that. So when I see things like this that a sales team is given and saying, go get them, you know, I feel bad for the salespeople. Now, I know that sometimes we have to consider the budgets. You know, maybe all that they could put into this was, looks like it's a two-color piece, right? Maybe you didn't have budget for a four-color. Why don't you just print it digitally? I mean, it's difficult to identify what you should change, right? Because sometimes it's more than the piece itself. But where we have the opportunity to make an impact, to use our education, our experience, and the wisdom that we have gained over time to make positive change in these tools, then each investment can generate a return. Kind of what I really think I'm trying to get to, right? Now, I call this whole program Market Ready Index. I came up with this idea in 2008 and have been working on it on and off for some time. And I want to explain how it kind of all comes together. And just take note, right? Please don't misconstrue this for a thinly veiled commercial for my business and Market Ready Index. I share this colleague to colleague of how what I'm figuring out and what's working, right? There are a lot of different assessment tools that you can use for different channels. Some may be more appropriate than others, right? How many people can afford a $100,000 brand review from EY? There you go.
This is a challenge. There's a lot of different types of audits that are evaluating individual channels. There are best practices that each of our professional trade organizations are presenting to us over time. Right? But what are we doing with it? You know, what are we doing with these things that we know? We're trying to apply them in a methodical process. We're trying to apply them when we remember all of them to the work that we do on a regular basis. And I'm one that I can't remember everything I learned, right? So I wrote it down. My dad used to always say, you know, you don't have it until you write it down. So I started writing things down, and we started referencing things that we learned and that we knew on a regular basis. That's how we generate the processes for Ideahaus. That's how we're able to evaluate our own work internally, and that's how we're helping people evaluate their work externally. So let's talk about where we're at. So this is the B2C score. Now, B2C is a little higher because trying to fight for a nickel at a mall is hard work, or online, right? So the top line is where the target scores are. I'll give you an idea of the neighborhood you should be in. So, like, remember, green, good, you know, yellow, slow down, red, bad. Anything red is bad. I don't know anything red that's good, right? So we help into the self-assessment that we made available to you guys. The ability to come in and get some sort of evaluation on how you do it, right? And so we'll give you the best practices on top. Like, so for instance, on the brain for a B2C customer, right, we've got it targeted at 71, top of that is at 76. Now, you can't tell me you want to go fight at the mall and not have a decent brand, right? Like, just think about being at the mall, right? Forever 21, my 14-year-old drags me there all the time, right? And I get out cheap, which is kind of nice. Right, so they're not a great brand, right? They're like an okay brand. You've got to be at least that to show up at the mall and spend that kind of money on that kind of square footage and driving that many little girls to get through there for like $3 this and a $5 that, you know? So, and I'm not saying you have to be 100. That's the thing I want you to notice on this. I'm not saying you have to be perfect, but you got to be good enough, and the pieces have to come together, or you're not going to make it. You're not going to make it in the mall. Right now, your marketing has got to be targeted, right? It's a little higher than your brand, right? You got to. I think it's coming to 79. So you have to know who you're going after. You have to know who your market is. You have to know how you're going to get to them, right? Your advertising is nearly as important. Right? Now, your design, not that big important. Your design is not as important as your marketing and advertising in a B2C situation. All right, so as you go through each of these elements, this is where I'm trying to think. It's, you know, one part education, one part experience, little dash of common sense, just says you have to hit these marks if you think you're going to be able to compete. And if you don't, why are you putting money in? Unless you just got a lot of money to burn. Who has like a superfluous budget that you have to work so hard to burn that you would move forward? You know, I mean, that's my point. Nobody has an extra budget. This isn't like Brewster's Millions. Remember Brewster's Millions? Right? Yeah, yeah. All the people in the back. Yeah, I saw it. Richard Pryor. So this is one of these challenges. All these things that we know, what are we doing with it? Right? So on your, now when you get into internet, social media, they've got consumer expect that to be high, multimedia not so much. PR, you gotta have some good things happening. You gotta have some decent events, and sales are critical because it funds the B2C machine. Right, so when we look at the 10 channels of communication, right, the thing I want you to ask yourself is, am I participating in enough of the right channels because I'm a B2C company? Right, because I see some B2C people like, I'm like, what are you doing? Like, well, we have a website, and we ran some ads, and you know, and they start kind of trailing off. I'm like, great, you're 2 of 10 channels, but you're a B2C company. How do you do that? You can't. You can't succeed in 2 channels as a B2C company. Now, what about other companies? What if I'm B2B? Right, well, it changes a little bit. Notice the change. Right, we drop a little bit because you don't have to have the same levels of performance. Because B2B is still competitive, it's just not as competitive as a B2C environment. Do you agree with this statement?
right? So we dropped some things, right? So branding is still like, you know, it's not that branding isn't important because I'm B2B. It's still important. People still want to like work with like the cool kids. Like, oh, they're cool. They have a nice logo. Yeah, that's part of it, right? But that whole look and feel is very important, right? But not as important, right? And then here, B2B, we're really looking at events and sales. They're much more important than for instance, design or social media. Now, nonprofits, right? We changed them again for nonprofits because a nonprofit business is very different than other types of businesses as well. All of these all of these different charts are available on Market Ready Index website. There's Market Ready Index Facebook page. There's a Twitter, at Market Ready Index. We'll share some of this stuff out. So thank you for taking pictures. It makes me feel like we're really important. But you can grab this stuff online as well, right? And you can reference it all in kind of context. So so how prepared is your business to compete in an overcrowded marketplace? That's my question to you. And I found out from some of you. So just quickly about beginning this self-assessment. Actually, I wanted to get into here, right? So here's one that came in. Gretchen here? Gretchen from Elder Help San Diego, very familiar with the group. So this is Gretchen's self-evaluation of the work for her organization, right? Brand is killing it, which I would agree. I see much of your marketing. Advertising is coming into the zone. Your design exceeds. You scored your internet on the lower side, but it's still good. Your social media, I agree, you guys do great social media. Multimedia, I'd like to learn more about that. She thinks that and PR is down. Events is in the zone, and sales is in the zone. Gretchen, I'm interested in what was your, how did you react to this data when you got it on the back end? Did it make sense? Is that what you thought you would do?
It did. We just redid our logo. So we feel really good about that and how that promotes our message and our mission. But I feel like a lot of our multimedia is kind of distorted. So, we have some e-blasts and we're still working on our website. So we know that's kind of probably our weakest link in terms of internet.
Was this helpful in just reaffirming some things, Was there any surprises?
No, there were no surprises.
Okay. Tommy Adelano.
Yes,
Tommy
sir. Here.
Thanks for playing my game. This is where Tommy came in. Tommy, a lot of red, buddy.
Hey, I'm here with the company.
A lot of red. That's right. Now, listen, again, this is a subjective evaluation. So, Tommy, just tell me real quickly, did you learn anything through this, and was it helpful in any way for you?
Actually, what I ended up doing, I ended up passing off to management. I'm fairly new with the company, been in the industry, but on the print side, print mail atmosphere. So it did, and looking, being new and seeing our company, I see the objective of where it needs to be. So, and what you discussed this morning so far.
Great, thank you. All right, let's jump to this next one, because I know we're wrapping it up here in 2 minutes, says Parker. Terry from Mission Fed. Terry? Talk about Terry when she's not here.
Hi, I'm just be careful.
So this is where we came in here. Overall, you can see on the top where she's on the plus side of most of this stuff. On the top, we'll tell you the score is 67.7. She's 11.3 under the B2C score. And it seems like the internet area is probably where she wants to get down to work on a little more, and then on the advertising. So as we go through this kind of stuff, I want you to kind of remember that assessments can help. Don't be afraid from assessments, right? Would you rather know before something bad happened, or would you rather know your work was not up to par after your boss allowed you to put a ton of money into it? How many people would rather know before? How many people are hoping for the best after? Yeah, right? So, like, hope is not a plan, right? So it's these types of things. There's a lot of different situations that this can really be beneficial for. So where you have more questions about how to evaluate your own work, please reach out to me. This is what I do for fun. My wife loves that I get to come and do this stuff because she doesn't have to talk about me and with me about this stuff anymore, right? But whatever you do, no matter the type of business that you are in, you gotta know if you're ready to compete. Thanks everybody for playing my game this morning.
Bye, Mom. See you later.
you. I did his assessment tool. I encourage you to go through it. You also get the results, just like we saw with Elder Helton and some others. That expression, what gets measured, gets
what?
Managed.
Improved. Also, what gets measured gets done. Yeah.
Whoa.
How could you use the assessment tool for nonprofits here in your proposals?